Welcome to Pregnancy and Postpartum TV. Today I'm going to be talking about all the things I did to induce my labor at 37 weeks successfully. I mentioned this before in my prenatal yoga and exercises to induce labor, and I had a bunch of questions about it, and I've been actually really sick for the last week, and I'm not quite well enough to do exercise yet, so I thought this would be a good time to do this video. I pretty much did all of the things that I could find that were safe. Some of them were evidence-based and others were not, but they weren't harmful, so I went ahead and tried them anyways. Because I had cholestasis, I knew that I was going to be induced medically at 37 weeks if I wasn't able to do it naturally, so I wanted to try everything to try to get things going on my own. Of course, this is general information only and what I tried to induce my labor. If you're interested in trying any of these, make sure that you talk to your healthcare provider before you try it to make sure it's safe in your pregnancy. Number one is, of course, labor-inducing exercises like squats and lunges, getting your body in a good position, making sure that you're upright in good posture, leaning forward and not slouching and hunching. I was also bouncing on the ball a lot, going for walks, and I was even hiking as well. And in case you haven't already seen it, I will link to my labor-inducing workout in the cards or in the description box below. Number two is I started drinking red raspberry leaf tea starting in the third trimester. I started with 1 cup a day and increased to 4 cups a day. The evidence that it induces labor isn't very strong. It's actually quite weak. However, there have been 2 larger human trials that showed that it was safe, and so I thought that I would try it anyways. Number three is I asked my midwives for a stretch and sweep or a membrane sweep. And basically, your health provider, once you are term, so at least 37 weeks, they will go in and separate the membrane of your amniotic sac from your cervix. And this does have evidence that this can help move things along. If you get this done, you want to make sure that you bring a pad with you. You may get a little bit of bleeding or discharge after. I didn't find it painful. I know other moms have said that it was painful or uncomfortable. I found it to be a little bit of a pinchy feeling, but it really only lasted a couple of minutes and it wasn't that uncomfortable. Number four is I ate all the foods that said may help you put you into labor. So this includes foods like pineapple, dates. I had one nurse tell me that she ate a bag of cherries. And again, these things aren't harmful to a pregnancy. They're safe. And the evidence is quite weak. However, I thought that I would try just in case. I did overdo it on the pineapples. I think I almost ate a whole pineapple, ended up with mouth sores. And so I don't recommend eating too much pineapple. There is actually some evidence that date fruit can increase cervical ripening, can reduce the risk for needing a medical induction, and also decrease risk for postpartum hemorrhage after a mom has the baby. And so because I enjoy dates, because they were safe, I went ahead and I had quite a few dates. And so I'm not sure if that contributed or not, but it was something that I did. However, if you have gestational diabetes, any of the studies didn't include moms with gestational diabetes. And I know that it is important to have good blood sugars right up until the very end. So dates are high glycemic index, even higher than white sugar. Actually, sugars can cross the placenta barrier. If the baby's blood sugar is higher, then the baby's pancreas is going to kick out insulin. And then if the baby is born and doesn't have that source of sugar from the mom anymore, that's when the baby can run into a low blood sugar. So this wouldn't be recommended for moms with gestational diabetes. Number five, I used prenatal massage. Not only was this relaxing and enjoyable for me, but they used the acupressure points that are said to induce labor. Again, the evidence is pretty weak, but I didn't figure that there was any harm in trying this. So the acupressure points that they used were between the thumb and the finger there, as well as behind the shin bone right here. They included those points. They also used a therapeutic grade of essential oil, so clary sage and rosemary, and they mixed it with coconut oil as well to hopefully try to induce my labor. Number six, I did prenatal acupuncture designed to induce labor. Again, I sort of left this up to the professionals, but I did notice that they also used the acupuncture in these areas and then around my feet, as well as other places on my body as well. And I did 3 different sessions and they sort of worked their way up in what they were doing. Again, I'm not sure if this helped, but I was able to induce my labor. Number seven, we used sex to try to stimulate labor. So there are 3 evidence-based reasons why sex may help to induce labor. So oxytocin may be produced, which is one of the labor hormones as well as orgasm is similar in a way to the contractions and may stimulate the onset of contractions, as well as the prostaglandins in semen may contribute to cervical ripening. Number 8 is nipple stimulation, and there is quite a bit of evidence to show that nipple stimulation may help bring on labor. In the randomized control trials, 37% of the women in the nipple stimulation group went into labor, while only 6 of the women in the control group went into labor. And again, the reasoning behind this is because nipple stimulation is said to produce oxytocin, which is the labor hormone produced by the pituitary gland. The larger randomized controlled trials show that there was no adverse outcomes for nipple stimulation. However, there have been a few case reports of uterine hyperstimulation, which was explained to me as basically one big contraction, but unfortunately the baby isn't able to get enough oxygen, so we don't want to cause hyperstimulation either. So I wanted to be very careful. I just did it manually with my hands. I felt it was a little bit safer for me. And I just kind of rolled my nipple on one at a time for about 5 minutes. I gave myself about a 30-minute break, and then I moved to the other side and did back and forth with lots of breaks between. Someone do use a breast pump, and so you could do it on one side, give yourself a break. On the other side, again, it would be best to talk to your healthcare provider. Also, there is some cases where the healthcare provider may want to monitor your uterine contractions while you're doing this to make sure that you aren't going to have that uterine hyperstimulation. Those were the methods that I used to induce my labor at 37 weeks, the day before I was supposed to be induced. There are a couple of other things that I didn't use. So other mothers may try a midwife's brew with castor oil. I didn't do this, they said for a couple of reasons, but it can cause diarrhea and nausea. And I didn't really think that that sounded like a lot of fun while you're trying to deliver a baby, as well as I had cholestasis. And because of that, I was on a low fat diet. And so castor oil is going to be high fat. And I really just didn't want any complications with that. So that's not something I did. I actually will link to the recipe below in the description box in case it's something that you want to ask your healthcare professionals about. You may also hear about evening primrose oil. I also didn't use EPO because of the lack of evidence. And again, for me, it was fat-based and it was something that I wanted to avoid because I had cholestasis. All right, that's it. I hope that you found that helpful. I'm going to go take a nap now and get better so that I can get back to making more pregnancy and postpartum videos. I'm going to keep making them every week. If you like videos like these, please subscribe, hit the notification bell, give this video a thumbs up, and share it with another mom friend or mom community that you think would find it helpful.